lights. When we continue our series on grace encounters, but once we finish, we are praying and seeking the Lord on the area of developing and enhancing relationship skills, all right, in your personal life, with your friends, and as well as children, spouse, so many areas. So yeah, we keep on praying. We launch it in a couple of weeks' time. Okay, wonderful Jesus. Now, how many of us know that tithes and offering is different from miracle seed? Because of a different purpose. The tithes and offering, windows of heaven open, and you're going to see the blessing for the present in your relationship, in your business, in every areas of your life. But miracle seed, you're sowing to a legacy. All right, long after we are gone, the building going to be there. And amazing blessing sowing to your legacy. So do not confuse, don't go and take it from the tithes and offering, give it to the miracle seed, then you're not giving. You're just putting one place to another. And another reason why we encourage you to use the envelope for your tithes and offering miracle seed is that so our finance department will be able to put the money in the right place. Yeah, Pastor, you do all the recording. No, not I, the finance department. And it's Bible-based. The Bible talk about every amount that is being given by God's people will record it very clearly in the book of Numbers, in the book of Esther, and in Nehemiah. Every offering given to the Lord's house and for the temple was clearly recorded in the rebuilding of the wall. Every one of those that given was recorded by the scribe and is recorded in the Bible. Yeah, so this is why we do that. Yeah, so that we, above all, we need to know whether it is for tithes and offering, which is very important because they will continue to help your church to leave an impact today in this place as well as all over the world. So, yeah, and Jeremiah 32, 40, and I will make an everlasting covenant with them. I will never stop doing good for them. This is a description of open heaven. How many would like to have open heaven? Yeah, I will never stop doing good for them, and I will put the desire in their heart to worship me. And when you give, it's not just about getting monetary return, that is of course part of it, but at the same time, there's going to be a spiritual blessing as well. And your children, your grandchildren, your spouse will have a desire for God to worship Him. Because where your treasure is, that's going to be your heart. So when you put your treasure in God's house, the heart is going to be there. There's going to be that spiritual awakening. And they will never leave me, your kids, your children, your spouse. I will rejoice in doing them good. It's not just about, wow, God giving us blessing, but He actually are so happy, delights, rejoicing in doing them good. And I will plant them in this land where God has placed you. All right, the Bible tells us in Psalm 92 that planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of the Lord. How many plant your papaya or plant your durian in a couple of weeks' time, you pull it out? No, you're not going to get fruits if you just get transplanted every now and then. So very important to be planted, be faithful where God placed you. And God said, I will plant them in this land in faithfulness and with all my heart, with all my soul. And this miracle seed, we're going to collect after the message. It's really a blessing given to... Sometimes I wonder, why God you give it to us of all the pastors? There are hundreds of pastors. I think that question was answered by a prophecy given by Tony Cripp that, He chose us by His grace. And look at the site. And look at the map of PJ and KL. You notice you just put right in the center. And one of the advisory team member highlighted to us, we have a great team of technical team, of architects, engineers. They do voluntarily for us, do the preliminary drawing. And then we have a building team. Later on, they're going to be implementing. Then we have the advisory team giving us good advices. And one of them just say, he took out a map of PJKL, and they point right to the center. That's where our site. I never seen it before. So right in the center, so I believe that's amazing. I mean, the value just a year ago, I heard, was 71 million ringgit, plus an additional 40 million already used to build the four-story car park, 1,700 car parks, total square area of 158,000 square feet, almost 4 acres. And we're going to show you again some of the prophetic. Pastor, I heard it before. Yeah, every time we hear it, like what Pastor Vernon prophesied today when I heard it, it kind of rekindled something on the inside of me. 1 Timothy 4:14 says, do not neglect the gift that is in you. This is given to you by prophecy, with the laying on of hands of the eldership. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them, that your progress may be evident to all. So what's some of this? Maurice Cirillo, when he came,
We stand on what we call holy ground. Because this is not the work of a man. This is the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And then look at the clip of the MRT station. There's only a piece, big piece of land that is adjacent just to a MRT station, a RLT station. How many of us know that God has given us an amazing, amazing heritage that we can sow towards our legacy? It's not just about me, it's about our children's children, and thousands of souls going to be saved in that place. Let's watch what Paul and Pastor Vernon gave the word.
Yes, my children. Mark my words, many churches will adopt the standards that I bring through your ministry, and it shall keep them secure and grow in multivarious ways. Even the secular realm will come and unite their hearts with you. The ministry shall bring forth new songs which will go forth around the world. So many departments will be formed in the ministry even before that building is completed.
The focus now is not so much on the building, the building. We are preparing it like kings, like Solomon. We make adequate preparation, abundant preparation as kings in the marketplace. The focus is not just on the building. The focus right now is building the various ministry. Right now, we are already in the process of developing, and you will see that we are developing a lot of things, even here in this place, so that we can prepare our heart and our people for the new century that God has given us. Watch this prophecy given by Pastor Vernon years ago.
This is my project, saith the Lord. It's my project. Okay, sometimes you kind of feel like it's too big. It's too big, but God says, if it's not too big for me, it will not be too big for you.
That is where you're going to see the 10,000 member church. But that's only the beginning. It will go beyond, way beyond that. Okay? So that's the start of the 10,000 member church. God is going to really pour out upon the church members in the church just a huge wave of finances, tremendous financial and material breakthroughs like they have not imagined. God really wants to let them know that it is for the purpose of the gospel. He really wants them to be big sowers of the gospel, to the gospel. And there's going to be many challenges of faith that he's going to give them. And as they take those challenges of faith, God's going to take them to a higher level all the time. The church, the Lord is declaring right now, should have billionaires. There should be billionaires. And there should be many billionaires. And God is raising up these billionaires from nothing, from nothing. And this is what he's doing, okay?
Praise God. So in a moment, we're going to take the offering, which is the tithes and offering. Same color, but do not be confused. This is the tithes and offering envelope. Do not take from the tithes and offering, give it the miracle seed, because then you'll not be giving. Yeah, because different offering, I believe God gives special blessing for it. So miracle seed is after the message.
Hello, everyone, and welcome home to RLC. If this is your first time here, head down to the Vineyard Lounge where you can receive a free gift from us and know more about our ministry here in RLC.
We dream of a strong local church, mighty in the grace of God, reaching out with great compassion, discipled and transformed by the love of Christ.
Updates and sermon notes, you can download our app. Just search for Renewal Lutheran Church.
Follow us on Instagram at Oasis of Care and Ablaze RLC.
I shall bow In humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art. My soul, something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me whole. Oh, since I met my blessed Savior, and since he cleansed and made me whole, oh, I will never cease to praise him. I'll shout it while eternity rolls, for he touched me. Oh, he touched me, and oh, what a joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know he touched me and made me.
I'd like to share my testimony, which is also in your bulletin. In the midst of escalating protests in Hong Kong, our flight was affected. We could not afford to miss the flight as we need to board a cruise ship in Hong Kong the following day, which has been fully paid for and non-refundable. We were told that for two consecutive days, all flights are cancelled. We were exhausted from multiple phone calls, and were prepared for the worst. My wife and I had planned for the cruise trip about a year ago, and in our helpless state, we paused, we prayed, we worshipped the Lord, and committed the situation to Him, knowing that only a miracle can change the situation. That was 2:30 a.m. on the day of our flight, which was at 9 o'clock. We slept for a few hours and we tried to call again at 5 a.m. And this time we were told that our flight was on schedule. Thank God we arrived Hong Kong on time. We made it. It was a miracle indeed. Then came another hurdle, a lost luggage. We knew that if God can take us so far, He will make it smooth for us. And so we decided to pray again. And we made the report for the lost luggage. And before we left, we were told that some bags were misrouted to the cargo. We were told to wait. And praise the Lord, after 1-2 hours, our bag came out. And so we left the airport. Later in the evening, we found out that the protesters at the airport grew larger after we had left. And all flights were cancelled subsequently after ours. We made it to the cruise, we had an enjoyable time, and we came back as well. And I don't think it's coincidence that one day after we arrived, KLIA had a major IT disruption and there were a lot of delays, baggage were lost. And the way I look at it, it was as though God parted the Red Sea for us. He opened a door, a window of opportunity that everything went on smoothly. Before we go, we were advised not to go to Hong Kong. Friends and relatives said the situation is unfavorable, but we just committed everything unto the Lord and we came back in one piece. And I just want to add that when God opens the door, nobody can close it. All honor and glory unto the Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Indeed, God opened the opportunities of the hour. God opened the way. In whatever situations that we're going through, we am sure the hand of the Lord is behind it, that helping us and in our favor. Shall we pray? Father, we thank you, we praise you, we commit this time unto your hand. We ask that your Holy Spirit to be in our midst to minister to us through your word. And Father, that your word will go forth and to bring that to minister to your people and to break yokes and bondages and to bring breakthroughs. And Father, we, in the name of Jesus, we come against all distraction, command you to go from our midst and never return in Jesus' name. And Father, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There was a Christian that he went fishing with a group of non-Christians. And they were non-believers and they went for a boat, went fishing. And when they were in the midst of the deep sea, suddenly there was a heavy storm. The boat almost sank. One of the friends asked him to pray. He said, since you are a Christian, can you please pray and ask your God to help us? And the man said, okay, I have not done this for many years. Well, I will try. And he said, God, I haven't asked anything of you in 15 years. And if you help me, us now, and bring us safely to the land, I promise you, I won't bother you again for another 15. There's a book in the Bible that God's name was never mentioned at all. If we can find it, I'll give you $50. Or even 50 US, if you can find it. And that is the book of Esther. But we can see God's hand throughout the book. We can see the great crisis ended with great opportunities. You see, the people of God throughout the world were celebrating this. They are celebrating this festival every year that is Purim. And this celebration, they will send gifts to one another and also even do charity to the poor. It's an amazing celebration. Amazing festival. In fact, this event happened. It's the same like the time that God's people leave Egypt. They have great deliverance during Moses' time. It's just like the same. You see, this festival is called Purim. Purim is actually the lot, the stone, the broken stone. And in those days, they use it to determine an issue. They ask the Lord, what should we do? Even the pagans, they use it to ask the Lord, you know, what should they do or this, and things like that. You see, this celebration of Purim is actually to remember how God delivered his people from total annihilation. It happens that in about 5 centuries before Christ, that's about 450 BC. You see, God's people, they were marked to kill on the 13th of the month of Adar. But God turned it around. They have the greatest deliverance. Esther 9, verse 22.
He told them to celebrate these days with feasting and gladness, and by giving gifts of food to each other and presents to the poor. This would commemorate a time when God's people gained relief from their enemies, when their sorrow was turned into gladness and their mourning into joy.
You see, even though God's name is not mentioned in the book of Esther, but we can see the invisible hand of God is at work. God is working behind the scene. He's releasing his supernatural favor in the midst of crisis. You see, God has already prepared the solution before the problem arises. Esther 1, verse 1.
These events happened in the days of King Xerxes, who reigned over 127 provinces, stretching from India to Ethiopia.
King Xerxes was the king of the great Persian Empire. You see how big it is, okay? It's stretching even from India to Ethiopia. It's really big. And he was the king. And in his third year of reigns, he had a great celebration for 180 days. That is about half a year. And a great celebration. And a great banquet. But in the midst of his anger, he deposed Queen Vashti, because Queen Vashti refused to be a presence in his invitation in the banquet. And later, Esther was made to be queen. Who is this Esther? Esther is actually an orphan. Her family and other God's people were taken as captives during the Babylon king, Nebuchadnezzar. And Esther was raised up by his cousin. In fact, you can say that it's her uncle Mordecai. And the name of Esther is actually a Persian's name. It's called Star. You see, it's not by coincidence that one day when Mordecai, he was at the king's gate, it happens that he heard about the plots of two eunuchs that were trying to kill the king, to assassinate the king. But Mordecai heard it. He reported to Esther, and it saved the king's life. But somehow, the king has forgotten about him. Instead, the king promoted Haman. How would you feel if you had done so much things for your company, if you had done so much things for your boss, if you had done so much things for your family, for your loved ones, and people just take it for granted and forgot about it? But sometimes later, you see, Haman received so many blessings, which he didn't earn for it. Yet he received a lot of blessings. But he focused on one thing that he didn't have. Just like many times when we have so many things, but we just focus on one thing we don't have. You know, we have cars, we have house, we have everything. But just one thing, perhaps, maybe it's a small handbag that we don't have. Just focus on one thing. It's the same like Haman. He just focused on one thing that he didn't have, that is, Mordecai refused to bow down to him. And because of that, he was upset, he was angry. And in the end, he decided to kill him, but not just to him alone, but also to all the people of God. Esther 2, verse 6.
So he decided it was not enough to lay hands on Mordecai alone. Instead, he looked for a way to destroy all the people of God, throughout the entire empire of Xerxes.
You see how bitterness can be that destructive. You hate the person and even hate the whole family. And he instigates the king to destroy millions of people. But good news is, God is always behind the scene and helping us. We do not need to fear. Even when we face such challenges, whatever situation that you are in your company, in your career, in your business, when you face people that are trying to sabotage you, trying to take away your business, trying to take away your positions, but the Lord is always there. Isaiah 54:17.
No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and every tongue which raises against you in judgment you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord.
The righteousness is from the Lord. This is our heritage. Do not be afraid of any things that are against you. You see, the Lord already put Esther in position of influence even before the problem arises. I'm sure there are many beautiful ladies in Persia during those days. But Esther was chosen to be the queen. It was not by coincidence. And it wasn't by coincidence that Mordecai was at the king's gate and heard the plot of the two eunuchs. And he saved the king's life. It's not by coincidence. And it's also not by coincidence that the king couldn't sleep and read the history of his reign and discover that he forgot to reward Mordecai. Incidents happen is not by coincidence. Oh, coincidentally, I met someone. Coincident, I believe the Lord is behind the scene and to arrange the time, the right time, right place for you to meet the right person. That's why the Chinese words of saying 天时地利人和, the right time, that God make it, the right place, right time, and right people, and everything that God make it mixed together that to accomplish great things. So the Lord, a lot of things is not by coincidence. The Lord is actually arranged things even before things happen. And God's supernatural favor also released for such a time as this. Esther received supernatural favor, not only by one person, not only once, but many times and from many people. She has the favor before the eunuchs because the eunuch will put her in the best place and get the best people to serve her. And also, she has the favor before the people. Esther 2:15.
And Esther obtained favor in the sight of all who saw her.
And she even had favor in the sight of the king. Esther 2:17.
The king loved Esther more than all the other women, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight, more than all the virgins. So he set the royal crown upon her head and made her queen instead of Vashti.
Esther had so much favor with all people surrounded her. Why? Because God's favor was upon her. When she heard that Haman had plotted to kill all the people of God, including she herself, she was hesitant. She was hesitating whether to help or not, because she hasn't revealed her identity. But she knew that if she helped, it wasn't easy, because no one was supposed to see the king without his calling, unless he holds his golden scepter, because the golden scepter is a sign of favor. But if the king didn't hold his golden scepter, then she might be killed there and then at that moment. And she knew it, that the Lord that the king had not called her for 30 days. 30 days, the king, didn't even call for her. And it wasn't easy whether she'd see the king or not to. But Mordecai reminded her in Esther 14, verse 14.
For if you remain completely silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. Yet who knows whether you have come to the kingdom for such a time as this.
Or the other NLT translation said, perhaps you will make queen for such a time as this. There is a purpose. There is a purpose for her to be in that position of influence. You see, when Mordecai and Esther heard about the plot of Haman, and if they just sat down and cry and see themselves as victim, poor me, oh, I'm going to die on such a day, because that is the final judgment, that's the sentences for all of us. If both of them just sat down, like others, just tore their clothes and cry, in the end, they themselves would be ended up in the gallows. But they decided to rise up to do something. You see, when we are in the midst of challenges, a lot of times that we'll grumble, we'll blame this, we'll blame that, blame this person, blame that person. It's no point doing that. Because the more we complain, the more we nag, it doesn't change the situation. But as we come to the Lord will give us solution. So Esther, she decided to seek the Lord to ask for his help. And she decided to rise up to the occasion. She said that, I will go to see the king. If I must die, I must die. No matter how, that she know that she either die at that appointed day or die then. No matter how, this also you die. Might as well I do something for it. She was willing to take a bold step of faith. You see, faith may appear to be very risky, but that is the wisest thing to do. Esther seek the Lord, and he asked the people of God to fast together with her. Why? She was seeking for God's favor. She knew that she cannot see the king because she was not called. She cannot take she couldn't take the initiative to go forth. She knew that she was not called. So she had to seek God for his favor. You see, to seek God's favor is actually not, prayer is not earning for God's favor, but is actually seeking him and his way, his timing, his wisdom to overcome the situation and even to thrive. Hebrews 11 verse 6.
But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
So he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Seek him. You see, there's when we are in the midst of challenges, if we just grumbling, crying, murmuring, self-pity, we ended up using a lot of human way. And very often that we like to use human ways to do things. For example, looking for this for help, looking that for help, finding this solution, that solution, instead of looking for God. Just like Jesus' time, people went to the temple of God instead of seeking God, but they look for business opportunities. And they were busy doing business in the temple, and in the end, they missed the greatest blessing, that is the visitation of the Lord. You see, one word from God can bring a great breakthrough. Dr. Cho, once he was sharing preaching in his church, and one member actually was seeking for the direction of the Lord to show him what business to go into. And when Pastor Cho was talking about, you know, Christian have to rise up to be the light and the salt of the world, and suddenly this member received the revelation. The revelation of doing the salt business. He took it as the Lord is speaking to him a rhema word. And it, in the end, it's true that his business was very successful. I remember sometimes back that there was once a pastor was sharing that how my mother was healed from his kneecap pain. And in the midst, that one member received that testimony and immediately she received healing for her knee. And there was once I preached when I was sharing about someone, I was in the midst of my preaching, I was sharing about, in fact, it was an evangelistic meeting. And I was sharing about someone was healed from the heart condition. Immediately, a non-believer, after the session, she felt the touch of the Lord and he felt the healing of the Lord. See, when we concentrate, when we focus on the Lord in the preaching, in worshiping the Lord, somehow the Lord can touch us. And that word can be a rhema and change our whole life, change our whole destiny. So focus on the Lord. And as we seek the Lord, we see God will surely give us great breakthrough. As Esther, she was seeking the Lord, and the Lord grant her wisdom to deal with the situation. You see, she wasn't like, you know, in a hurry. Okay, now I can see the king. Now the next minute, I want the king to hang Haman immediately. She didn't. She received wisdom. She received favor, went to see the king. And not any other day, not the second day, but the third day. So she has wisdom. The Lord has the right timing. When she seek the Lord gave her the right timing to see the king. When she seek the Lord gave her wisdom to deal with Haman. And in the end, make Haman fall into his own plot and bring great reversal and Haman fall into his own trap. As Esther stepped out boldly, she received great favor. And the king, instead of being killed, the king even offered her half of his kingdom. So Esther, that she knew that when she came to the Lord, seek the Lord grant her the bonus. Esther 5 verse 2.
So it was, when the king saw Queen Esther standing in the court, that she found favor in his sight. And the king held out to Esther the golden scepter that was in his hand. Then Esther went near and touched the top of the scepter.
You see, the king held out to Esther the golden scepter. He was releasing favor to her. But not only that, Esther took initiative to touch the top of the scepter without asking. What does scepter mean? Hebrew 1 verse 8.
But to the son he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom.
The scepter is righteousness. She took initiative to touch the scepter. When she received favor, and when she received favor, she was bold enough to ask, to touch the scepter, to ask from the king. See, we know that God is in control of time and seasons. When God asks us to do something, it is the perfect timing. Even though in God's eyes, it wasn't the perfect timing to see the king, but yet, to God is a perfect timing. God instructed Esther when to see the king boldly. And even though when it's not the right time, but God can make it the perfect timing. You see, God's people were marked to be destroyed on a particular day, but instead Haman was hanged on the gallows, and he and his son were killed. And then Mordecai, later on, was being raised to be the second to the king. So you see, God really intervened and helped his people. He delivered his people and granted them great victory. And even people around them were afraid of them. Esther verse 17 said, people around them became God's people because fear of God's people fell upon them. They were afraid they would be killed. So they also declared that themselves, they are God's people. We can see the greatest adversity turned to be the greatest blessings. The greatest crisis become the greatest opportunities. Esther went to see the king on the third day. It sounds familiar because Jesus was in the wedding feast on the third day in Cana of Sea of Galilee. On the third day, Jesus resurrected on the third day. 1 Corinthians 15:4.
And that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the scriptures.
See, God is able to revive dead situations because of the resurrection of Jesus. And he turned the adversity to be blessing. In 1940, that was during the Second World War, it was a crisis because Hitler was really advancing and overrunning Holland and France. And then it looks like the Germans' advance appeared to be unstoppable. On May 9, the Prime Minister of England, Neville Chamberlain, he resigned. He says that, let's see if anyone else can handle this mess. To him, it's a mess, it's a gone case. No hope. And then on May 10, Buckingham Palace called Winston Churchill to see the king. And the king looked at him and said, and look at Winston Churchill and say, I want to ask you to form a government. And Winston Churchill agreed. Later, he wrote that, he said, as I went to the bed at about 3 a.m., I was conscious of profound sense of relief. At last, I had the authority to give directions over the whole scene. I felt as if I were walking with destiny, and that all my past life had been but a preparation for this hour and for this trial. He found his destiny. He found his purpose. God has a destiny for us. God had a purpose for us. Therefore, be like Esther, lay hold of the opportunities. When the opportunity of window is open and when the opportunity of hour is open, rise up to the occasion and make a great impact in God's kingdom. The same as you saw in the miracle seed. You can make a great impact. I believe not only for the generations to come, even for our generations. That special, special anointing in the miracle seeds. Because we believe miracle seeds will also bring miracles in your life, in all aspects of your life. Restoration of relationship, restoration of what you have lost, restoration of health. And we believe that we are investing into the kingdom of God and even for your own miracles to happen.
Praise the Lord. The Lord is good. Turn to the person to the right and left of you and say, I'm hungry for God. Tell them again, I'm hungry for God. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. You know, God gives us something called divine opportunity. And anytime you receive divine opportunity, you get a challenge of faith. And when you take challenges of faith, those challenges take you beyond where you are. How many want to go beyond where you are? Challenges of faith take you beyond where you are. Okay? How many want to go beyond where they are? Okay? Number two, it takes you beyond your current provision. How many want to go beyond their provision? Can you say amen? And one of the things that you see throughout the Bible is God's challenging men and women. Challenging men and women. If you take the challenge, your provision increases, your anointing increases, you go far beyond where you are. If you don't take the challenge, you don't go anywhere. You stay basically the same. Can you say amen? And God's given us a challenge of faith today as we sow seed. And this seed today will be deemed as miracle seed. And miracle seed releases in a miracle anointing, not only for the multiplication of the seed, but miracles in your life, in your family's life, and people who are associated with you. Okay, because God is God of miracles. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He has not changed. Can you say amen? So this is where you pray. Ask the Lord what to sow. Whatever he tells you to sow, do it. Just like Cana of Galilee. Mary said, whatever he tells you to do, what? Do it. You don't even have to think. You just do it. Can you say amen? For example, how many in here have ever had an itch? No one in here has ever had an itch? Turn to the person right and left and say, Jesus, raise me from the dead. Let's get some life in here. Hallelujah. You guys gotta need some life. Response. Can you say amen? How many in here ever had an itch? Okay, when you have an itch, what do? You don't think about it, do you? Oops. Excuse me. No. Hallelujah. Yes, sister. Let you hold it, okay? Hallelujah. You just do it, correct? And when God says, gives you a challenge of faith, just do it. Because he is going to confirm his word. He's going to make it good. Can you say amen? So pray and ask the Lord what he would have for you to sow. And what he tells you to do, do it. Can you say amen? And if it's an amount you do not have, you pledge it. You pledge it. Now, pledging is good. You know why? Because pledging takes you beyond what you would normally sow. And every time you sow, God is going to multiply that seed sown. Can you say amen? And pledging is, don't wait, wait till I get the big deal, then I pledge it, then I'm going to do it. No, you sow out of what you have. And as you sow out of what you have, God multiplies that seed. You sow, he multiplies. You sow, you multiply, he multiplies, and guess what? You'll find out that you'll reach that particular amount. Amen? Now, sister, you say something here.
Brother.
Yes.
Praise God. Amen. You know, I always ask the Lord, what do I tell him? And this is a little bit unusual. How many of you like to build your own home? Come on. All of us, right? Well, that's all we're doing. But not our own home. We're building God's home. Amen. Yes, our bodies are the temple of the Holy Ghost. Amen? The body of Christ is not contained in a building, but the body of Christ needs a building, and that building is God's house. That's how you look at it. Amen? So when you're giving, like for instance, if you want to build a house, you try to put everything in it. Am I correct? Yes? So it looks nice, right? Well, how much more God's house? Amen? You see, we come in here into his house to meet him. Not just to meet each other, but to meet him in his house. So that's why in our hearts, we should really just want to do everything we can to give him his beautiful house. Are you with me? Amen? Because that's what it is. Not just a building, it's God's house. Okay? And if we can build our own home so beautifully, how much more God's house? How much more will God give to you to build his house? Amen? So, don't be stingy. I mean, if you're going to build your own home, you're not going to be stingy, am I correct?
Amen.
You're going to make sure that everything that you need is good. Amen? And that's the same with God's house. So when you're sowing into God's house.
That's how you see it. And God's house, because we are His children, is our house. Amen?
Amen.
So that's how you look at it. Amen?
Praise God.
Praise God. Hallelujah. What I'd like for you to do is to hold up your seed. See, your seed is special to God. Number one, you as a person, of how you honor the Lord. And number two, the gift that you give. And the Lord has given me the anointing to release financial and material blessings, and my wife the gift of special faith. So this miracle anointing, now when I say lift up your seed, you guys need to obey. Lift up your seed. See? Praise God. This is how you get blessing, by simply obeying what God says. The very simple things, okay? Hold up your seed. Hallelujah. Because your seed is precious before the Lord. Can you say amen? Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. There you go. That's the anointing that's falling. Miracle anointing. Because as we pray, we deem this to be miracle seed. Can you say amen? Oh, hallelujah. Just pray in tongues a moment. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lift it up high. Oh, hallelujah. Lift it up high. You're lifting it up to the Lord. Can you say amen? There you go. It's starting to fall right now. Father, in Jesus' name, we deem this seed to be miracle seed. To release miracles in every aspect and in every way concerning their lives, their family, and people they are associated with. We thank you, Lord, for instant miracles, multiplication of this seed, great, much more surpassing, shining favor to pour out upon them, Lord. Ooh, in the name of Jesus. We thank you for it. Ooh, there's that anointing. As God's holy angels are coming in here right now. In the name of Jesus, we break the power of all withholding spirits. Command you to go from them in the name of Jesus. We're loose right now. Lord, blessings in every aspect of their life. Shumo, hallelujah. Thank you,
and
Jesus.
Father, in the name of Jesus, you have given me the special gift of faith. When I call the things that be not as though they are, I see them happen. And Father, in the name of Jesus, people have been given. They've been giving. You see the hearts, Lord. And there are some who really desire their own home, and it's not happening. And Father, right now I speak that those people who have desired to have their own home will receive their own home because they're giving you your home, Lord. I've asked for it right now. I thank you for it, Lord, because you said that when I speak it, it will happen. Amen. And Father, I thank you and I praise you. Oh, Lord, there are some people that look at their bank account and they say, I wish I could give more, but I can't. Lord, fill it up. Fill it up, Father. Fill it up right now in the name of Jesus so that they can give more in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We thank you for everything that you've done for us. We thank you for everything that you're doing for us. But most of all, Lord, we just thank you for your love. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your love.
Say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I expect miracles.
Miracles.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I expect many miracles.
Many, many miracles.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I expect great eight miracles.
Great miracles.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I expect great eight outpourings of miracles into my life, into my family's life, into people associated with me, into my church,
my
business, and whatever I set my hand to do, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Pastor Vernon talk about pledges, and if you've not brought your check, there's no problem. Just write down your pledge, and will bring on whatever date. And so you may want to make a pledge and then you TT over, transfer the money over. I think the details are all inside here, but when you do transfer, do indicate in your transfer send an email that amount is for miracle seed. As I said, it's good to put in an envelope so that our finance department will be able to record it as such, whether it be tithes and offering, or anyone need a copy of this, just raise a hand, ushers will pass down to you. Some of you just may not get it when you walk in. Anyone? Wonderful Jesus. So if you want to make a pledge, you've not brought your checkbook, just write down when you're going to bring, and perhaps this week you TT over, or the next week with a check. So whatever it is, indicate to us it's miracle seed. Now we're going to pray a special prayer of blessing upon this seed, even right now it's been planted. Father, thank you for giving us a promise, even as we give. Lord, we know that the windows of heaven are going to be open. We declare surely that everlasting covenant that you promised us, you will never cease doing us good. For surely what we have seen even right now in terms of our blessing is only but a tip of the iceberg. There are much more we have not seen, but we know that you will bless us in open heaven because you've given us a promise. You never stop doing good for us. Not only that you're going to bless us financially, but also in every area of our life, that there will be that desire in the hearts of all our loved ones, our children, our spouse, all our relatives, Father, our friends, who have a passion for you, a desire to worship you in your house. Because even as the Word has given us the promise that where the treasure is, there's going to be the heart. Even as our treasure is in your house, the passion for your house is going to be there. We declare that our loved one will truly serve you, worship you, and you will never leave us. Thank you, Lord, you give us the promise that not that you wanted to bless us, but you rejoice in giving us good blessing. And you rejoice in doing us good. And you will plant us in this land that will never be uprooted and will be able to flourish in your courts. Lord, we will thank you for this beautiful opportunity for such a time as this that you place us with that right position, right opportunity to really sow in our present and our future legacy. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Give God a hand. Thank you, Jesus. How wonderful it is in our church. So many different teams. Huh? Next team going to come, the service communion, the usher team, security team, Sunday school team, just to mention a few, cafe team. Wow, praise God. Give God a hand for all of you here serving the house of the Lord. Third day, Esther approached the king. And then the king raised up a scepter, which is a picture of righteousness. And she reaches her hand to touch that scepter. It speaks of the righteousness of Christ coming to us. The third day, the fact that he rose again shows us that redemption is completed. That everything that we owe God has been settled, paid for in full by the Lord Jesus Christ. And what is left for us is his supernatural profuse favor. Because of that, we can have great confidence for such a time as this. God could use us in a way beyond our wildest imagination. Would you pray this prayer together with me? Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for being my good shepherd. Right now, I receive you into my life as my shepherd, as my Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I know even I make bad choices, you are with me, you are for me, and you will sort things out for me. Because you are the good shepherd who have already laid down your life for me. And all the people say, Amen.
Prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to us.